no massive amounts of genomic data are being generated. And just to give you an example, if we continue at this rate of growth, where data is doubling every 7 months, we will have more than 1 zettabyte of genomic data by 2025. And even if we were to take a more moderate estimate, given by the Moore's law, still we will get more than 1 exabyte of data. So it's important to design compression algorithms, especially because, as you know, like the data is generated in sequencing centers that then is transmitted to either companies or research institutions, then this data is analyzed, a lot of time stored in public repositories. So if we can decrease the size of the data, accessing the data is going to become faster, and also because the size of the data is smaller, storing it is going to become also cheaper. Now, what are the data volumes and the data files we are working on? Now, as output of the sequencing machine, we generally get a FASTQ file that contains all the reads from our genome sequenced. Now, regarding the site, it's going to depend on the coverage, but if we talk about 200 coverage, which is already possible with Illumina technology, for example, the FASTQ file that is going to be generated is going to be of the order of the terabytes. Now, once we get this raw data, typically we perform the alignment, so we are going to map each of these reads to a reference genome, and that's going to generate a SAM file. And because it contains the same information of the FASTQ file plus all the alignment information, the size is going to be typically 2 times that of the FASTQ file, so in this case about 3 terabytes. And now typically the last step is to perform the variant calling, because what we care about is the differences between the genome that we sequence and that of a reference genome. And all these variants that are found are stored in a BCF file, which is about 1 gigabyte. Now, if everything was perfect, we could just store the BCF file because it contains the information that we care about. However, because these tools that are used for alignment and variant calling keep improving over time, most of the time we are going to store the FASTQ and the SAM file so that in the future we can redo the analysis and maybe find variants that were missed the first time we analyzed the data. Now, so in this talk, I'm going to focus first on compression of the SAM file, and then I'm going to move on to compression of the genotype information that is stored in the BCF files. Now, there has been a lot of research in compression of SAM files. However, when you go online to download a SAM file, normally it's either in the BAM format, which is just a binary version of the SAM file, or either in the CRAMP format, which is a more specialized compressor that is gaining popularity today. And as you can see, CRAMP can already achieve about 40% improvement with respect to BAM file. Now, one of the questions that we wanted to ask is if we can really decrease the size of the CRAMP file, for example. Can we decrease this number further? Now, if you look at the compressed size, you realize that the current bottleneck is the quality scores. And they occupy about 70 or 80% of the compressed file. Now, quality scores indicate the reliability of each of the base pairs that are generated by the sequencing machine. And the reason they occupy about 70, 80% of the compressed file is because, first of all, the alphabet is much larger, it's about 40. They are also noisy, and therefore the entropy is higher, and that's why they are more difficult to compress. Now, this is actually good news, because if you think about this plot, what we really care about are the reads. Those are the ones that contain the biological information. And these quality scores are really an artifact of current sequencing technologies to account for the sequencing errors. And therefore, research is going towards lossless compression of the reads and lossy compression of the quality scores. And in this sense, there has been a lot of research in recent years, and here I just show some of the proposed algorithms in the literature. Now, in 2015, we proposed QVC, and I'm going to focus in this tool for this talk. So the aim of QVC is to optimize for the rate distortion performance. And for those of you who are not familiar, let me just go through this very quickly. Let's assume that we need about 3 bits per quality score to achieve lossless compression. Now, you can imagine that we can use a fewer number of bits at the cost of introducing a distortion, in the sense that the reconstructed quality scores are going to be slightly different from the original ones. And the fewer number of bits that you use, the more distortion you are going to get. So what we wanted to do is to push this curve to the corner as much as possible so that for the same number of bits, you can get fewer distortion. So how do we do this? So the characteristics of QVC, which was presented in 2015, are the following. We can achieve any point in the rate distortion curve. So we can go from lossless compression to 0 bits per quality score. And is the user the one who decides at which rate wants to work? And at the same time, because it's not clear which distortion you want to minimize, we let the user the flexibility of deciding which distortion metric. It can be mean square error, it can be L1, or any other metric. So I'm not gonna go into the details of the algorithm in the interest of time, but just to give you the main idea, what we do is the following. We model the quality scores at each position as a Markov of order one, and this is based on analyzing the statistics of the quality scores. And then based on these statistics that we can compute empirically from the data, we can create quantizers, and then use these quantizers to quantize the quality scores, and finally compress them with an arithmetic encoder. So what is the performance of the algorithm? Here I plot the average mean square error versus the number of bits per quality score, and the performance of QVC is here shown in black. Now the other colors indicate the performance of previously proposed algorithms. So as you can see, we are better in terms of rate distortion performance for all rates, for small rates and for higher rates. We can also achieve lossless compression. Sorry. So I don't know why we are not showing the numbers here, but this point of lossless is about 2 bits per quality score. Now, so even though traditionally rate distortion has been used to analyze lossy compression, here we are talking about genomic data. And even though this gives us a sense of how the algorithm is performing, people are more interested in understanding the effect that lossy compression is going to have in the further analysis that we perform on the data. So in that regard, we perform an extensive analysis on variant calling. And for that, we used BWA for the alignment. And then for variant calling, because there are several tools, we decided to use GATK, some tools, and Platypus. I'm going to give here some highlights of the results, but if you are interested, you can go to this paper here in Briefings in Bioinformatics, where you have an extensive analysis. Now, for the data set, we use the human individual that has been extensively studied in the past, and for which we have a consensus of SNPs that are assumed to be correct. So that means that when we run this analysis after applying our lossy compression, we are going to get a VCF file, and we can compare the variance in this VCF file with that of the ground truth. And this allows us to compute the sensitivity, the precision, and the F score of our sets. And we want these numbers to be as high as possible, to be as close as possible to the ground truth. So we did this analysis, and I'm showing here the average results. And let me walk you through this plot. Here I show the number of bits per quality score. And in this first plot, I show the sensitivity. Here I show the precision, and finally the F score. Now, because as I said, we use different tools for variant calling. All the results that are shown here in blue correspond to the tool GATK. The results in orange to Platypus, and the results in purple to some tools. So different colors means that we used a different tool for variant calling when performing the analysis. Now this point most on the right corresponds to lossless compression, and that's why it uses the most number of bits per quality score. So there are several things to notice in this plot. So first of all, as expected, introducing lossy compression introduces some small variability in the results. However, this variability is much more smaller than the variability that already exists between different tools that are used to perform variant calling. Now, someone may argue that maybe quality scores are not used in practice, but that is actually not true. And as you can see, for very small rates, we do see a degradation in the performance. And based on these results, it seems like we should be using about 1 bit per quality score so as not to get a lot of degradation in the quality scores. So we wanted to know if we could improve further these small rates. So we did a further improvement for our algorithm, and basically we clustered the data prior to compression. So instead of assuming that all the data is generated by a Markov of order one, we assume there is a mixture of Markov models. So then we use the EM algorithm to find the parameters of this model and also to decide which read was generated from which model. And just by doing this, we can get improvement for very small reads, for example, here for GATK. And more impressively, for Platypus, we see this boost in performance. Now, something that I did not comment about is that because we have this variability introduced by the lossy compressor, sometimes what actually happens is that the performance that we get is actually better than that achieved by lossless compression. And this makes sense because, as I said, quality scores are a bit noisy and they are not used in an optimal way for the variant calls, and therefore sometimes you may get this boost in performance. However, it's not clear for which rate you are going to get an improvement. You really need to run the pipeline and get a sense. So with that in mind, we ask the following question. Can we consistently improve the variant calling performance while still reducing the size of the data? And what comes to mind when answering this question is denoising of the quality scores. And the idea here is to explicitly reduce the noise on the data so that we can improve the inference. And by doing that, because there is less noise, there is also the entropy is also reduced, which means that we can still get improvement in compression. Now, there are some challenges with this because, first of all, we don't know the statistics of the noise. And also, we want the algorithm to be robust against all the variant colors that are used in practice. But still, we were able to propose the first denoising scheme in the literature for quality scores. And I'm not going to go into the details, but just the idea is to use a lossy compressor followed by the lossy decompressor. So we get this reconstructed quality scores Q hat. And then there is this post-processing operation that used the original quality scores and the reconstructed ones to output the denoised values. Now, if you want to get the size of the data when you compress, you need to apply a lossless compressor at the end of this. So what is the intuition of this scheme? So assume these are the quality score sequences, Q, that are composed of the true quality scores, Xn, that are not available to us, plus some noise, Cn. Now, when you apply a lossy compressor at distortion D, you are going to get a reconstruction sequence within this radius of Q. Now, you can imagine that by choosing the right distortion metric and the right distortion level, this reconstruction sequence could actually be the true quality scores Xn. So this is the idea of the algorithm, and more formally, the lossy compression is going to partially remove the noise and learn the statistics in the process. And then this post-processing operation, is you can think of it as performing Bayesian denoising. One of the challenges here is that for this scheme to work, the distortion that with the lossy compressor should work depends on the statistics of the noise, which are unknown for us. But we can apply the lossy compressor at different distortion levels and see what happens. So that's what we did. And here I saw the results just for GATK. And for simplicity, I saw the F score versus the distortion level at the lossy compressor. And the black line corresponds to the original performance with the lossless data. And the blue line corresponds to the denoised performance where QVC is used as the lossy compressor. So as we can see, as we increase the distortion, we get an improvement in the performance, but only up to a point. Then if we keep increasing the distortion, then we see that there is a huge degradation. So it seems that there is this point here where we can do very well, and not only we can improve the performance, we can also do so by still decreasing the size of the data. So in this case, the original data occupied about 600 megabytes, and we can decrease that to 400 megabytes. And by doing denoising, we see more consistent across all data sets for a given data set because you can analyze the noise of the data and then get a sense of at which distortion the lossy compressor should work. So this is just a first approach towards the denoising of the quality scores, but I think more research can be done in this direction. And with this, I want to conclude this part and move towards compression of the VCF files. So the idea here is that we wanted to compress the information on the VCF file, but allow for random access. So in particular, we wanted to be time and memory efficient when decompressing a specific variant across all the samples. And we also wanted to have random access column-wise, in the sense that if you want to decompress the genotype of a given sample, we should be able to do this also very fast and in memory efficient. So we proposed GTRAC in 2016, and this work is going to be presented in detail in the ACCB conference, so if you happen to be there in September, we will talk about this in more detail. So the idea is to take the VCF file and split it in two parts. One is the variant dictionary, when we have the set of all the variants, and then we create for each sample a binary vector that has a one if a specific variant is present and a zero otherwise. And with that, we construct a binary matrix that we want to compress. So I'm not going to explain the compression algorithm in detail, just to give you some of the methods that you used. We use Lempel-Sieve-based parsing algorithms, 16-bit vector structures, and also variable byte encoding. So I'm just going to focus on the results for now. So we took a data set from the 1,000 genomes project of human data with about 1,000 deployed samples. Now this VCF file is about 170 gigabytes. Now once we go from the VCF file to the variant dictionary and the binary matrix, this occupies about 11 gigabytes. Now I want to emphasize that for now we are only focusing on the variant information. We are not storing the quality of each of the calls and all the other information that is stored in the VCF file. That's why there is a huge decrease already just by doing that. And just to give you some results, we compare our algorithm GTRAC with that of 7SIP and with that of TGC. That is an algorithm that was proposed in 2013 for compression of these files. Now, the difference with TGC is that there is no random access here. That's why there is this trade-off between compression ratio and random access. So as you can see, our compression is worse, as expected. So we are about more than 2 times worse. However, when we look at the decompression time and the decompression memory, we are much faster. So in particular, we are able to decompress a specific genome in about 1 second and a specific variant in just milliseconds. And also the memory that we use for that is also much lower. It's about 90 megabytes in compared with 1 gigabyte of TGC and 7-seq. So these are preliminary results, and we are working on adding all these other features of the course, like the quality and so on. Thank you very much. And all the tools are available in our website if you are interested in those.